It's a single leading cause of death in the US. It strikes men and women, young and old. It claims one life every 35 seconds. It's heart disease. And right now, you, your wife, your husband, your mother, your father might be at risk. Today, we'll meet one of the millions of families affected by heart disease, a family right here in South Florida.
This was his only hope. He didn't have much of a choice. This was his last choice.
I was playing golf and had a bad case of shortness of breath and some angina.
He started having problems and he could barely carry out the trash. He couldn't breathe. And it was very depressing to him because he was so active.
If you lay down flat in bed at night and want to go to sleep, you cannot. You can sit up and maybe correct it to where you can stand it. If none of those things work, you end up in the emergency room in the hospital.
We know that if nothing is done, 90% of people will be dead within a year.
Today, we'll go to the University of Miami Health System and meet Bill Koppelman as he fights for his life against all hope and against all odds. We'll also meet a team of doctors and scientists participating in a national trial to develop a breakthrough treatment, still in the experimental phase, and watch as they use this breakthrough to try to save Mr. Koppelman's life. Hello, I'm Melinda Lee, and this is Breakthrough Medicine, a medical series highlighting life-changing treatments and procedures at UHealth, the University of Miami Health System. Powered by the Miller School of Medicine's groundbreaking research and education, UHealth delivers leading-edge patient care throughout South Florida and beyond. Each day at UHealth, medical breakthroughs give patients a second chance at life. Today, we're going to meet one of these patients, Bill Koppelman, a man in his late 80s who has had a history of heart disease. In fact, he is already in the throes of congestive heart failure. And in a recent visit to his local hospital, he was diagnosed with a common but deadly condition known as aortic stenosis. Under ideal circumstances, open heart surgery would be the solution. But for Mr. Koppelman, his critical condition eliminates that option. For Bill, time is running out.
Aortic stenosis is a very dangerous disease. It's been treated with heart surgery for the last 50 years, and it's a wonderful operation. But there are very many people who are at advanced age or have a lot of other medical problems like severe lung disease that makes it really almost impossible for them to have heart operations, open heart surgery. A lot of people in the country have this disease but can't be treated with open heart surgery.
For most patients who have a previous history of heart disease and are in poor health, doctors often have no treatment options. Fortunately for Bill, he found an experimental treatment that might just save his life. Here at UHealth, a team of doctors will perform an innovative procedure using a simple device that may offer a glimmer of hope for Bill and his family. Mr. Koppelman suffers from a disease called aortic stenosis, a condition where the valve in his heart has become calcified, making it nearly impossible for his heart to pump blood through his body. A healthy valve, like this one, is flexible and can easily open and allow the heart to pump blood where it is needed. However, Bill Koppelman's heart valve has become calcified and rigid. This is aortic stenosis.
Aortic stenosis is a disease that has a worse prognosis than some of the most malignant cancers. Very few people live more than a year after they start developing severe symptoms.
Not long ago, Bill Koppelman knew something was wrong. He felt the warning signs of aortic stenosis.
I called my cardiologist and had an appointment and went into his office. And he said that it was the results of a aortic heart valve that was building up with calcium.
He had been turned down by two cardiothoracic surgeons. He decided that he had had enough, and he went down to the University of Miami for the aortic valve replacement procedure.
Mr. Koppelman first sought help at a local hospital.
They could not do it, and their procedure of doing it is opening your chest. I went to another hospital, and they told me the same thing. And at that point, I began trying to find a place that had done an operation without opening up your chest.
Mr. Koppelman's search led him to one of the few people in the world who may be able to save him, renowned interventional cardiologist William O'Neill, a man whose own family faced a life and death crisis with heart disease. A life-changing event that inspired him to dedicate his career to helping people like Mr. Koppelman.
My father had a massive heart attack when I was 15, and I was in the hospital as a young boy watching him have two cardiac arrests and almost die, and watching how the doctors took care of him during that was really the original inspiration for wanting to be involved with that.
What he's doing gives elderly people another chance at life.
When the heart contracts, the valve opens and sends blood out to the body. Normally, there's no resistance, but when people get this disease called aortic stenosis, the valve, rather than opening very easily, is very rigid and can't open. It causes an enormous strain on the heart. One out of three people over the age of 80 have a problem with their valve. Well, Mr. Koppelman is a gentleman in his late 80s. He's had previous heart attack. He's actually had a previous open heart operation. And all of those make another operation very risky. He was seen by his own doctor and the surgeons in his community, and they thought that it was impossible to operate on him. And we know that if nothing is done, 90% of people will be dead within a year.
Fortunately for Bill Koppelman, there may be another option. A new procedure, still in the experimental or clinical trial phase. These trials test the effectiveness of new medical procedures and how safe they may be. It is within this process of advancing medical science that Mr. Koppelman may find his last hope.
In a layman's terms, it's experimental, is what a lot of people call it, and I'm willing to take that opportunity to have it done.
More than 1,500 active clinical trials are underway at the University of Miami Miller School of Medicine. For this clinical trial, Dr. O'Neill has assembled a team of cardiovascular specialists that includes Dr. Alan Heldman, Dr. Omida Velasquez, and Dr. Pedro Martinez-Clark. This team will replace Bill Koppelman's diseased heart valve without open heart surgery.
Dr. Heldman, how are you?
Yeah.
Dr. Alan Heldman is the principal investigator for this clinical trial at the Miller School of Medicine. And he, along with Dr. O'Neill, who was the first doctor in North America to perform this procedure, is among only a handful of cardiovascular specialists conducting this clinical trial in the United States.
The development of a technique to replace the valve non-surgically is very exciting for us. The technique consists essentially of a catheter, a large catheter, which is delivered to the spot where the valve sits in the heart. And then with a balloon, the valve is opened and a new device is implanted by that balloon expansion.
Dr. Heldman and Dr. O'Neill, along with their cath lab team, will implant a small device into Bill Koppelman's heart. The device, only about 1 inch in size, consists of a valve stitched inside a stainless steel frame, which is implanted and held in place by the patient's calcified valve.
This new method of putting valves in without heart surgery, percutaneous valve procedure, is very new. It's not approved by the FDA yet. There are approximately 15 centers in the U.S. that are performing it. It's not very widely available. The University of Miami Hospital is the only hospital in Florida that currently is doing the procedure.
When we come back, we will learn more about this clinical trial and the lives it has changed. Every day at the University of Miami Health System, knowledge from clinical trials is translated into leading-edge treatments for patients who need it most. People like Harold Schoendorf, the first person in Florida to have an aortic valve replacement without open heart surgery.
The whole procedure is only about 2 hours, I believe. Which, compared to open heart, that was unbelievable. In this building, which is only 3 stories, which is 2 flights of stairs, I couldn't go up those stairs without losing my breath when I got to the second level. And I knew something was wrong. And that was going on for almost a year. And I said, man, this can't go on this way. This is just not the way to live.
The day after we did this procedure and implanted the new valve, I went to see him in the intensive care unit. He was sitting up reading the newspaper. He said, when can I go home? I feel great. He looked good, and you know, within a few days he was home. And next time we saw him, he said, yeah, you know, I went and walked 1/2 mile. Felt great. Back to work, doing everything I want to do. And it's a great success story.
Under the expert care of his UHealth doctors, Harold Schoendorf survived the first percutaneous aortic valve replacement in Florida. But Bill Koppelman is a different patient with a different history, and his prognosis is far from certain.
There are a lot of risks, and we explain that to the patient. We try to be very careful and control those, but it is still a very new procedure, and we're doing the trials to prove that this procedure is better than the alternative. And we'll know within about a year, once the studies are done, how much better people do compared to the alternative.
It's 5 a.m. on the day of the procedure. Bill Koppelman's doctors are about to attempt to replace his diseased aortic valve without open heart surgery.
You're in tip-top shape, all right?
Okay.
Everything is going to go very, very well.
Mr. Koppelman is part of a clinical trial at UHealth, the University of Miami Health System, where a team of cardiologists are using an experimental procedure to treat his aortic stenosis. The team will thread a catheter through an artery in his leg all the way to his heart. Then they will push aside his diseased valve with an artificial valve using a tiny balloon.
If you take a look, there are probably over 30 people that will be in the cath lab. There's 3 cardiologists, 1 cardiac surgeon, a cardiac anesthesiologist, and a vascular surgeon. And all of those people have to work together as a very orchestrated team, because the procedure has to go very, very smoothly in a set order of events.
I think Dr. O'Neill has said he's going to be able to play golf again and carry out the trash and do all the wonderful things that he did. Because when you lose your quality of life, it's not fun.
Not everyone with aortic stenosis is eligible for this clinical trial. And as with any surgery, there are risks. Doctors will first introduce a wire called a pacer wire to speed up his heart rate. Then they will guide the artificial valve device to his heart. At the moment the stent containing the new valve is put in place, they will actually stop his heart from beating.
We make the heart go very, very rapidly, and so basically the heart stops pumping. We kind of create a cardiac arrest, and then we put the new valve in and pull the balloon out, all of this over about a 15-second period of time. And we have to have a bunch of people that know exactly what's going on during the procedure so that everything goes in sequence. If we don't do things in sequence, then something catastrophic could happen.
They have to make a cut in the vessel. There's a big artery. We're going to put a big tube inside. And so the Dr. Velasquez is cutting down so that we can actually look at the vessel. And then there's going to be a big hole, so she's going to have to close it with surgery so that it won't bleed.
This is a very sophisticated procedure. My role is to assist with exposing the access artery and with getting the delivery system up into the aorta so that Dr. O'Neill can then use that delivery system to place the aortic valve in the heart.
Outside the cath lab, Mr. Koppelman's wife speaks with a nurse as the team prepares for the most critical part of the surgery.
Just to hear his voice strong on the phone, to say, hey, how'd you shoot today on the golf course? To know that he has dignity again.
LV is 141 over 24 and AO is 97 over 43.
We're ready for the valvuloplasty, right?
We're ready for the valvuloplasty.
We have to put the pacer wire in. So we're gonna get ready to test the pacer in just a minute, okay?
The pacer wire sends an electrical charge to the heart and speeds up the heartbeat. This pacer wire will actually cause a cardiac arrest to stop his heart long enough to place the new valve.
When we're doing the pacing, I want everybody really quiet in the room. We'll just let you know in just a second when we're going to start, okay? But when we start, I want everybody really quiet.
When we return, doctors will actually stop Mr. Koppelman's heart in their attempt to save his life. We're following Bill Koppelman, who has aortic stenosis, a deadly form of heart disease. He is too sick for open heart surgery, the standard treatment, but is now in the middle of an experimental treatment at the University of Miami Hospital. Here, a team of cardiologists and vascular surgeons are about to replace his valve without open heart surgery. They have inserted a guide wire through an artery in his leg and will actually stop his heart for a few seconds to implant a new artificial valve attached to a wire stent.
When we're doing the pacing, I want everybody really quiet in the room. We'll just let you know in just a second when we're going to start, okay? But when we start, I want everybody really quiet. Pacer on.
Pacer on.
Okay,
off.
What's your rate set at?
200.
Yeah, so we go down to 180.
180, please.
Kevin, we're ready for the valve.
The stent and balloon must be made the exact size for Mr. Koppelman's aortic valve. Otherwise, when his heart is restarted, the stent could leak or even come loose and the procedure would be a failure. Everything has led up to this moment. What happens in the next 15 seconds could be the difference between life or instant death for Mr. Koppelman.
When we place the valve has to be placed in exactly the right location. If we place the valve too high, it can break off and basically go out and float out into the body. If we place the valve too low, it can go into the heart and cause a catastrophe. The patients would die instantly.
You can't change anything, you know, if you don't do the thing exactly meticulous, you're going to make a mistake. So
a sequence occurs, we start pacing the heart very, very rapidly. The heart stops, so there's no blood going out to the body. We basically created a cardiac arrest. Then we've got the balloon meticulously placed. We blow the balloon up and then put the balloon down. The balloon will come out and the new valve stays in place. There's about a 15-second time frame where time is just absolutely life and death. And that occurs when we're actually putting the new valve in.
This is the most critical moment of the procedure, actually stopping the heart while a new valve is put in place.
Ready?
Yes.
Okay. Pacer on.
Pacer on.
Inject. That's it.
The team is still as they wait to see if the valve will stay in place.
Okay, here's LV and AO again.
Gradient is gone. Chris?
9.4.
LV is 128 over 30. And AO is 128 over 40.
It's a success. The new valve appears to be solidly in place.
We've got everything positioned here, so now Dr. Velasquez is just going to close the artery, and then we're going to move him to intensive care unit. So far, so good.
After more than 3 hours, doctors have successfully replaced Mr. Koppelman's heart valve, but it will be several days before we know how it will impact his lifestyle. While the team closes the incisions, Dr. O'Neill steps out to talk with Mrs. Koppelman.
Hi. It went very, very well. Okay.
Wonderful.
All right.
Wonderful.
He tolerated everything perfectly. He's asleep, so he doesn't know anything. I was able to put the new valve in place, okay, and it's working perfectly. We're going to have to keep a real careful eye on him, but so far, so good. So
thank
he did beautiful.
So much.
All right. My pleasure. Everything went very well. And we'll let you see him in a little bit later this morning, okay?
Okay.
All right, good.
Nice to see you. I'm very happy.
Okay. All right, I'll see you later soon. All right.
When we return, we will check back with Mr. Koppelman and his wife to find out just how this experimental procedure has changed his life. Life is finally back to normal for Mr. Koppelman as he steps back onto the golf course for the first time since his procedure.
certainly glad to be back with these guys, able to play golf a couple days a week with them. I feel like I'm a miracle sitting here.
He came out of the hospital, he's a completely renovated man as far as I'm concerned. I'm glad to see it too. We golfed together for many years. I hope we do many more years.
I had some doubts whether I'd see him again this year when I come back. And with a little prayers, here he is. And we're so glad to be with him.
Bill, it's good to see you back. Bad thing about it, you're playing better golf than I am.
I'm able to walk. I'm able to go out in the morning and pick up the newspapers for my neighbor and ourselves. All of those things that I could not do before. I was a sick person in a lounge chair with only a limited amount of time to live. That's all changed.
Clinical research is going to provide a wonderful advantage to the citizens of South Florida. This is the way that we advance the way patients are treated. New breakthroughs in medicine are going to provide new treatments that are not available elsewhere.
What he's doing gives elderly people another chance at life. I've never been in a hospital where I've been treated anywhere near as good. Well, I'm very grateful to Dr. O'Neill and his team for what they have done for me.
It's incredibly exhilarating to be part of it. It's wonderful to be part of a breakthrough that will allow patients to have better health and a better quality of life.
Clinical trials and research define academic medicine at University of Miami Health System, Miller School of Medicine, where UM faculty physicians and community physicians partner to provide innovative healthcare for patients. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Breakthrough Medicine. Make sure to stay tuned for upcoming shows where we will explore the latest advances in areas such as stem cell therapy, electrophysiology, orthopedics, including sports medicine, and other medical breakthroughs at UHealth, University of Miami Health System, Miller School of Medicine.